Assalamu alaikum. In this video, we are going to discuss preoperative preparation. You should know that the body perceives surgery just like an injury. So as soon as the surgeon makes an incision, cytokines are released, inflammatory changes start to occur, stress hormones are released, and body goes into a state of hypercoagulability. And these changes can cause complications during the surgery, and they may even last several post-operative days. So to minimize these unwanted physiological effects during and after the surgery, proper preoperative care should be given, which should be done 2 to 4 weeks before surgery, unless an emergency procedure is required. The preoperative preparation is divided into patient assessment and systemic assessment. Patient assessment includes history taking and a focused physical exam along with the required investigations, whereas a systemic assessment is performed to address the comorbidities if present. This includes assessment of cardiovascular system, respiratory system, genitourinary tract, hepatobiliary tract, diabetes mellitus, adrenal insufficiency and steroid therapy, patients on anticoagulants and patients on other medications. Now let's start with patient assessment. After you have taken a detailed history, you would know if the patient has any systemic disease or allergies or previously had a difficult experience with anesthesia and things like this. So these problems should be managed. And then in the physical exam, individual systems are reviewed to obtain information about the specific organ system. And this includes checking the vital signs, doing a general physical exam, cardiovascular exam, respiratory exam, abdominal exam, and a neurological exam. So if any problem is found in any of these systems, it should be addressed. Then based on this physical exam, if you are suspecting any comorbidity which you are not sure of, you are going to advise certain investigations, like a full blood count is advised if you are suspecting anemia or other coagulopathies, because if it is not corrected, it can cause excessive bleeding and cardiovascular events during the surgery. A urea and electrolyte test is done to detect any problems with the kidneys, so proper IV management can be given during and after the surgery. It is normally required in all patients over 65. Liver function test if there is suspicion of liver impairment like in hepatitis or jaundice. Clotting screen is done for patients on anticoagulants like aspirin or warfarin, etc., or with inherited coagulopathy or liver impairment, because they need to be corrected before surgery. Arterial blood gases are done in patients who have or are suspected to have breathing issues or lung disease. An ECG is performed in patients with a history of cardiovascular disease or for those undergoing major surgery, and in all patients over 65. Chest X-ray should be used only when necessary, and the indications may include respiratory illness, new cardiorespiratory symptoms, significant smoking history, and recent travel from areas with endemic tuberculosis. Urinalysis is also not done routinely, only when urinary tract infection is suspected. A pregnancy test or beta HCG is advised to all females of childbearing age, and always ensure to get the patient's consent. And lastly, blood glucose and HbA1c is advised to patients with diabetes mellitus or endocrine problems. So this was the patient assessment, now moving on to systemic assessment. In which the first one is cardiovascular assessment, because 1/3 of deaths during surgery are due to cardiovascular events, which in turn is because 1/3 of the patients undergoing non-cardiac surgery have cardiovascular diseases. So to avoid such events, patients at high risk should be identified. These include patients with hypertension or those who have had a myocardial infarction and those who have undergone coronary revascularization with stent, or patients with valvular heart disease. Now the complications which can arise due to poorly controlled blood pressure during surgery are blood pressure lability, which can cause arrhythmias, and myocardial ischemia and infarction. So to avoid these events, the ideal preoperative blood pressure is less than 140 by 90 in most patients, whereas it should be less than 130 by 80 in patients with diabetes mellitus and chronic kidney disease. And in patients with blood pressure over 180 by 110, surgery should be delayed until blood pressure is stabilized. And if the patient is prescribed a new antihypertensive, then a stabilization period of at least 2 weeks should be allowed before surgery. Next is myocardial infarction. If the patient has recently had an MI, then elective surgery is contraindicated. And it should be delayed 3 to 6 months because there is a high risk of perioperative reinfarction during this period. But if surgery is really necessary, then it can be performed within 4 to 6 weeks of MI with continuous close monitoring of the patient during the procedure. Now the patients with coronary artery stent. If the stent has been recently implanted and the patient is undergoing a non-cardiac surgery, there is an increased risk for stent thrombosis, consequent myocardial infarction and death. And since these patients are on dual antiplatelet therapy of aspirin and clopidogrel, there is also an increased risk of bleeding during the surgery. So ideally, the surgery should be delayed until the antiplatelet therapy is no longer needed, which is 6 weeks for patients with bare metal stents and 12 months or 1 year for patients with drug-eluting stents. But if surgery is absolutely necessary and there is also an increased risk of perioperative bleeding, then stop clopidogrel and continue only aspirin and perform the surgery. But now there is a risk of thrombosis, so start clopidogrel as soon as possible after the surgery to minimize risk of stent thrombosis. And if there is low risk of perioperative bleeding, then dual antiplatelet therapy can be continued and surgery can be performed. Next is valvular heart disease. To avoid hemodynamic alterations in patients with mechanical heart valves undergoing non-cardiac surgery, following measures are taken. Warfarin is stopped 5 days before surgery. And when the INR falls below 1.5, unfractionated heparin is infused. Then the APTT is monitored to keep it at 1.5 times normal. And heparin infusion is stopped 2 hours before surgery. Then in the post-operative period, heparin and warfarin both are given. And when the full effect of warfarin is achieved, heparin is stopped. Now moving on to respiratory assessment. Pulmonary complications are just as common as cardiac complications. So individuals who are at risk for such complications should be identified and managed. Like acute exacerbations of COPD or asthma patients should be treated first and surgery should be performed later. Or if the patient has a chest infection, then surgery should be rescheduled 4 to 6 weeks after starting antibiotics. Smokers should be advised to stop smoking 1 to 2 months prior to surgery. Asthma and COPD patients are advised to continue their regular medications. Asthma patients are also given a pre-treatment with steroids to reduce post-operative complications. A preoperative inspiratory muscle training is also effective in improving respiratory muscle function after the surgery. In high-risk patients, inhaled bronchodilators are also given perioperatively to reduce the risk of bronchospasm. Theophylline is avoided perioperatively because it may cause arrhythmia. Leukotriene inhibitor like montelukast is resumed when patient can tolerate oral medications. This was respiratory assessment, now moving on to genitourinary assessment. Patients who are at high risk for renal failure and kidney-related problems after surgery should be identified and managed preoperatively. These include patients with underlying conditions like diabetes mellitus, hypertension or ischemic heart disease and patients with chronic kidney disease. So the underlying conditions should be stabilized before surgery. In patients with CKD, full blood count and urea and electrolyte tests should be advised to detect acidosis, electrolyte imbalances and high creatinine levels. And these should be corrected. And patients with chronic end-stage renal disease should undergo dialysis before surgery as well as on the day after surgery. Now the urinary tract infections like uncomplicated UTI in females and infection by obstructive urinary tract
should be treated before elective surgery. But if it's an emergency procedure, then antibiotic is given and urine output is monitored before, during and after the surgery.
So this was everything about today's topic. Remaining part will be discussed in next video. Thank you for watching.